Welcome everybody to Scott's Gap for our morning service on this, the fifth Sunday of Easter. I'm here at Scott's Gap, and in particular I'm in front of the Mart, which is one of the famous buildings in Scott's Gap. We have from time to time had services there at Christmas, particularly the carol service, and at harvest time when we've had our harvest services. And in June, which we celebrate soon, in fact the 17th of June, on or around that date we celebrate John Wesley visiting this area. And I know for a fact that we have people at that service who have actually given their life to Christ when they've been amongst God people here. It's a great place to come and visit and look around. The chapel itself was founded in 1902, and the building where we are now opened in 1958. It's a great place to worship. We have a great tradition of music here, and I'm delighted that we can welcome Kathy Anderson to lead our worship today. But we begin with a reading from Scripture, and it's from the Acts of the Apostles and chapter 17. And it's Paul on his missionary journeys visiting Athens, and he is unnerved really by the pagan images around him where he is, and he's invited to the Areopagus to share some of the thoughts he has on the one God who he introduces to them. So I'm reading from the Acts of the Apostles and chapter 17. Paul then stood up in a meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or even stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice, for by the man he has appointed, he has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We will now take a moment's silence and have a short prayer. Let us pray. Spirit of truth, come close to us. Unite us into the body of Christ. Enable us to worship God in spirit and in truth. Help us to continue to support and encourage each other. Help us to love as we are loved. Spirit of truth, come and abide in us, Amen. We now continue in worship as Kathy leads us in our first hymn, Who the Son Sets Free Is Free Indeed. And so, let us pray. Heavenly Father, you make yourself known to us, and you are present in our lives, even though we do not always recognize or acknowledge you. For all that you are, we thank you, loving God. You do not leave us orphaned, but embrace us with parental love that encourages us and comforts us. For all that you are, we thank you, loving God. You ensure that we are not alone by filling us with your Spirit of truth that inspires and empowers us. For all that you are, we thank you, loving God. We thank you, Father, for your presence, your love, and your encouragement. A prayer of confession. God of love, we are sorry that at times our love for you falters, that we have wrong priorities, that we overlook your guidance. O God, forgive us and renew us. Loving Saviour, we are sorry that we disobey your commandments, that we fail to love, that we walk on the other side. O God, forgive us and renew us. Spirit of truth, we are sorry that we disregard your presence, that our thoughts and feelings are unrighteous, and that we follow the world's way. O God, forgive us and renew us. May your presence abiding in us lead us in the right way. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
The epistle today is from 1 Peter chapter 3. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behaviour in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. It is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring us to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. In that state he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, 8 in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves us also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. Amen.
The Gospel for today is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 14 and verses 15 to 21. Jesus promises the Holy Spirit. If you love me, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and to be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. Amen.
I'm thinking of my treasured sister and friend, Christine, or Chrissy as we called her. She painted the picture behind me. Chrissy was a jewel. God said so years ago. He sent a message by the Holy Spirit via a person who was praying for her. A jewel, colourful, precious. Chrissy loved the Lord and knew she could trust him because he'd been with her through every season of life and through every difficulty. And he was with her at the end in Cramlington Hospital on March the 26th. We know this because the Holy Spirit gave us a message through someone praying that Jesus was holding her by the hand. That brought us comfort when we couldn't go and visit her. We know where Chrissy is now because Jesus said, "There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I'm going to prepare a place for you." I wouldn't tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself so that you will be where I am. Dad would have sung, "Trusting as the moments fly, trusting as the days go by, trusting him whatever befall, trusting Jesus, that is all." And it says in Proverbs, "Trust in the Lord completely and do not rely on your own opinions. With all your heart, rely on him to guide you, and he will lead you in every decision you make." Jesus, take me as I am. I can come no other way. Take me deeper into you. Make my flesh life melt away. Make me like a precious stone, crystal clear and finely honed. Life of Jesus shining through, giving glory back to you. Jesus, take me as I am.
So let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. And so in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I've always loved the North East, and as a family we've got some very special memories. One in particular is of our son Matthew when we lived at Cramlington. As a family, we used to go across to the beach at Seaton Sluice regularly. It was a place that we loved to go. And I can remember after lunch one particular Sunday, it was suggested that we have a ride over to Seaton Sluice. And Matthew, who was about 5 or 6 at the time, looked out the dining window and saw the wind bending the trees outside and said, "Dad, if we want some fresh air and we want to experience God, could we not just open a window?" And I suppose there's a sense in which we can do that. But at times, to experience God and to be with God, then we often will find ourselves stepping out of our comfy zone. Today's text is taken from the gospel that we shared earlier. And it's John chapter 14 and verse 16. "And I will ask the Father, and he will send you another advocate to be with you forever." I don't know if you have ever listened to Desert Island Discs on Radio 4. I have. The programme actually aired initially on the Forces Radio on January the 29th, 1942, and has run now for over 77 years. The participants are asked to imagine they are marooned on a desert island and encouraged to share their 8 favourite tracks of music. For participating, they are gifted the complete works of Shakespeare, a luxury item of their choice, and a Bible or other book. At times, over the past 7 weeks, I felt marooned, isolated on some kind of desert island and missing much needed human contact. Let's face it, waving through a window has its limitations and it just isn't enough. Maintaining social distancing is difficult, sometimes almost impossible. I can remember a few weeks ago going for my daily exercise, and I was walking down Aquila Drive where I live, and I looked down and I found a debit card, which I picked up naturally. I didn't recognise the name upon it. And after walking a further 200 yards, I noticed one of my neighbours frantically looking around the road and the paths she was walking. And it became clear to me that I had in my possession what she was looking for. And of course I did. And I said to her, "Have you lost your debit card?" And she said, "Yes." And I took it out of my pocket. And her immediate reaction was to run to me to hug me. Initially, I was like a rabbit frozen in someone's headlights. And then I began to back off and almost fell over as I moved into the road. Of course, I deserved that hug, but I couldn't have it. because I had to socially distance from somebody who was very grateful that I'd come to her rescue. We're not designed for isolation, even though at times we might enjoy it. I don't know about you, only being able to see loved ones on a computer screen is also wearing a bit thin in our house. Telephone instead of face to face just doesn't scratch where you need to be scratched. Not being able to hold my grandchildren has been unbearable at times. Not so long ago, I was talking to my daughter Katie and my grandson Joshua, and he just looked up at his mum and said, "Can we go to Grandad's?" I immediately replied, "Can we come to yours?" Because that's where most of us are at this time. So, do you feel marooned? I want to remind you that you're not alone and to hang in there. What might be for you your luxury item? Have you listened to some good music? I know I have. Have you sung some hymns? I know I have. Have you turned to a good book? I know I have. Have you grabbed your Bible? I know that I have. What has mattered to you in this crisis? What has changed you in this Christness? What has brought you closer to God? What has been your go-to book in the Bible? In a crisis, what page of the Bible can you go to without fail? One of the pages for me has always been John chapter 14. It fits on one page. It speaks to me in all the circumstances of life. I even read it on one of the most difficult days of my life. I was at the graveside of my dad and my granddad, who died on the same day. And I wanted to read that scripture in the service, and I wasn't allowed to. So when everybody had gone, and with the permission of the gravedigger, before the grave was filled in, I stood at the graveside of my father and read John chapter 14. I go to prepare a place for you. In today's reading, I was quite taken by the opening verse. If you love me, you'll obey what I command. It seems to me that the word "if" here is a bit of a challenge. If you love me. Has anybody ever said that to you? If you love me. Has somebody perhaps tried to get you to do something? If you love me. Has somebody had the audacity to question the quality of your love? Because it can sometimes hurt. Remember when Peter was having a conversation with Jesus after the resurrection. Jesus, three times with three different emphases, said to him, "Do you love me?" Do you love me? It's simply because of this. Love is the foundation of our relationship with Jesus. It emphasises for all of us what obedience to Christ means. The call of discipleship, and in particular the command to love, means obeying his commandments as well. And he states that here in love. To follow his command means that we are never marooned when it comes to our relationship with Christ. I'll say that again. We are never marooned. It means that we matter to him. And even in the crisis which we face together in these times, we are never alone. The promise from the lips of Jesus is an advocate, a guide, a counsellor, a friend, indeed, the Spirit of truth. To love Jesus is the starting point in our relationship with him. So, if you love me, becomes important. And it's the starting point of this particular scripture. It carries with it the empowerment of the Holy Spirit and the love and acceptance of God. In verse 18, Jesus says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. And in verse 21, he says this, whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. So these are not just comforting words. They are the reality of knowing Jesus and loving him. And in the reality of that love, I offer the following thoughts. Firstly, we have a guide, sometimes described as an advocate and sometimes described as a counsellor. Some years ago, I remember going to a church friend's funeral. They had died very suddenly. It had been a complete shock. And the funeral was a wonderful celebration of a life. Wonderful celebration. And we learned at the funeral that for over 40 years, every year, several times a year for 40 years, B had always volunteered to take a blind person on holiday with her. B acted as a guide and was the eyes that her blind companion needed to enjoy a holiday. She even paid for that person's holiday. Nobody in the congregation knew of this act of love. I can remember there being gasps around the room because mine was one of them. Imagine the joy of having such a guide in your life. Imagine having such a gift. That's what the promise of this passage means to me. The story acts as a reminder to me of the special relationship Jesus promises here. The intimacy and the commitment that the Spirit brings. A guide and advocate. Empowerment for a short time and for all time. Sending the Holy Spirit as a guide is the seal of our relationship with Christ. It's an intimate relationship, if you like. It's a guarantee of never being marooned from Jesus. We might be marooned from much in life at this time, but Jesus is with us. Love and obedience brings us into vital communion with the Father and the Son. It will mean the Father and the Son will dwell in our hearts. And that Jesus is with us. And so I remind you of verse 21 again. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. My second point is about enrichment, and I want to tell you that we are enriched. That's what the Spirit brings. Our lives are enriched as we seek to serve Jesus in love and obey his commands. We become like him. I want to say that again. We become like him. You see, that's the point. Jesus says the Holy Spirit will come and abide as the Spirit of truth. And he also says here that the world cannot know him, but we can. He will dwell in us, and we are made pure. I talked earlier about go-to passages. Here's another one. It comes from Paul, and it's from his letter to the churches in Galatia. And in chapter 5, he says this. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. See, when we love Jesus and obey his commands, the evidence is there for all to see. We are peaceable, holy, humble. We become like Jesus. Obeying means that we cherish his sacred influences and live in his truth, and his truth lives in us. Jesus was soon to be taken away, but his Spirit would remain. Therefore, he would remain. We will know his presence and have assuring that we are always under his guidance. We are enriched with the promise we are not orphans, and reminded that we are the children of God. The Spirit of truth will be our comforter, our strength, and our fortress. He will bring to us when we need it most all our good moments with Jesus. All that Jesus speaks to us and teaches us in our lives will be there for us because he is in us. Sometimes in our most difficult times, he is there within us. And I believe that's why Peter in our lesson today is confident that by the Spirit of truth, we might be, in Peter's words, always ready. And he says this in 1 Peter chapter 3. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. And he qualifies this with this advice. But do this with gentleness and respect. It's a reminder that it comes out of us so naturally. However nervous we are, it comes that the love of Christ oozes from us when we follow him and love him and do what he commands us to do. Through the same Spirit at work in the ministry of Peter, we hear the voice of Jesus in our lives for today. By Jesus' Spirit, we are influenced in a way that will give us the right words in every situation. And finally, God takes hold of us. If you like, and you prefer this illustration, literally, by the hand. At a time when we are not allowed to take someone by the hand, even a loved one or a dear friend, God takes hold of us. I can't emphasize this enough, especially in our present circumstances. To open God's word is to find strength and meaning. I go now to a passage from the prophet Isaiah which speaks of the intimacy with God that Jesus promises. And Isaiah reminds us of this. I am the Lord your God, who takes you by the right hand and says to you, I, the Lord, have called you in my goodness. I will take hold of your hand. In a time when we are missing the physical contact of others, God takes us by the hand. That's what this relationship means for me. It would seem to me that intimacy with God is something that is always to be craved, even as much, if not more, than the human contact we have missed in lockdown. Through the love of God, we are never alone. When Paul has his first encounter with Jesus on the Damascus Road, if you remember, Paul is in a dark place and he's blinded by the light of Christ, and the voice of Christ stops him in his tracks. He's taken off to a strange house where he is for 3 days. When Paul is there, he's attended to by a man named Ananias. Now, I have always found this story wonderful. The truth is, Ananias does not want to go to Paul. In fact, in a conversation with God, he refuses to go. He's terrified. But he goes to Straight Street, as Jesus has commanded him to do. And placing his hands on Paul while he's there, he says, Brother Paul, the Lord Jesus has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. After this, Paul is baptized and sent out as God's ambassador to the Gentiles. Later in his ministry journey, we see the Apostle Paul in the Areopagus, enabled by the Spirit to preach the good news in a city where a pantheon of pagan symbols have truly disturbed him. Despite this, he is enabled by the same Spirit to bring the good news of the one true God. The God who made the heavens and the earth. He himself gives all people life and breath and everything else, that we might seek him and perhaps reach out to him. For in him we live and move and have our being. I close with the same words I started with. If you love me, you will obey my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will send you another advocate to be with you forever. Amen to that, friends. Amen to that. God bless you all. Amen.
Before our prayers of intercession, I would like to read an entry from our Celtic Daily Prayer Book. It's by the Northumbria Community Trust. It's a passage by Andy Rain entitled The Small Boats. When David and I read it last Friday morning, it resonated with us. And as you listen, bear in mind that this book was published in 2015, long before COVID-19 was heard of. Some years ago in intercession, we were warned of a rising tide of the Spirit that would change the landscape all around. People who had previously never been isolated would suddenly find themselves alone on small islands, surprised, bewildered, cut off from familiar demands and expectations, learning just to seek God. What do they need, these new island dwellers, so suddenly alone? They may feel isolated, but actually, they're more linked by the tide of the Spirit. A small boat appears. In the boat are willing friends, bringing much-needed encouragement and carefully chosen supplies. They also point out and recognise the resources already there, unnoticed and unharnessed in that place. God has prepared us for such a time as this. Are you willing to be anointed to the task of encouragement? Let us pray. Lord, these are very different days when we find our world changed beyond our recognition, when we are bewildered, isolated, and cut off from all that is familiar or comfortable or convenient. When we cannot physically be together with the people we love and long to see and hold. When our church families are apart and when our friends are out of reach. We are so grateful, Lord, for your Spirit uniting us with you and with each other and giving us strength, comfort and support. We thank you, Lord, for the commitment and vision of our ministers, who, while we are kept physically apart, have used this time as an opportunity to draw us together through the services that they produce each week. We ask that you bless them and inspire them as they continue to guide us through this new way of worshipping together as your family. We thank you, Lord, for the people around our circuit who bring us much needed encouragement and connection with their phone calls. For those who with a cheery wave deliver food supplies and medicines. We pray that you will keep them safe in your loving arms. And we ask that you speak into the heart of every Christian of every denomination, strengthening us and encouraging us so that we can give more of ourselves, so that more of you can be seen. Lord, we pray for our world. A world that is struggling in so many ways. A world where our greed and corruption has brought devastation, change and famine. A world where wars rage at the expense of the innocent. A world where food banks are necessary. A world of two halves, the haves and the have-nots. We pray for all leaders around the world. We pray for their well-being, for their wisdom and understanding. We pray that through your love, Lord, they will be guided to a greater compassion for their own people and for those of other nations. Lord, at this particular time, we have the extra anxiety, confusion, fear and sadness that this worldwide pandemic has brought. We pray you make your powerful presence known in the midst of this difficult time, and that your peace be given to all in need. We pray for the leaders of our own country. Please guide them in their decisions. We pray that they united in leading us through this crisis, that they put aside their own agendas and petty power struggles, that they may not be swayed by popular demand, Lord, but remain firm and united in what is best for the peoples of this nation. We pray, Lord, that your kingdom come and that your will, not ours, be done. Lord, we lift up all those people in our communities who selflessly continue to put their own lives at risk for our benefit. The NHS staff, the police, the firemen, the care home workers, the scientists, the armed forces, the vets, all those working in the food industry, from the farmers to the processors to the shop workers and the delivery drivers. All those who provide transport and childcare so that key workers can get to work. All the teachers and their online lessons so the education of our children continues. All those lone workers who are able to keep working in isolation, the electricians, plumbers, engineers. Lord, we lift up all those maintaining appropriate social distances or staying at home to reduce the chances of spreading this virus and making it possible to contain it to manageable levels. For the volunteers who deliver food and medicines, there are others, Lord, and we thank you for the blessing of each and every one of these people. We pray that the lessons learned about neighbourliness, thoughtfulness and compassion will continue as and when we emerge from this. We pray, Lord, that you will soften hearts of stone and give people the heart to seek you. And we ask that you will place us, your workers, alongside those in need. We pray, Lord, for those who are struggling with loneliness and isolation, for those devastated by the prolonged separation from their loved ones. We pray for those struggling with staying together in confined spaces and ask that you ease their frustrations and calm their anger so that it doesn't spill out on those they live with. We pray for those whose anxiety is an almost unbearable weight, pressing in on them, affecting their every thought and deed, giving them sleepless nights. Calm them, Lord. Keep them from harm. Enfold them in your peace. We pray for those awaiting routine but life-changing treatments put on hold while the NHS focus on caring for those with this virus. But we pray especially for those who are dying without their loved ones present. We ask that they may be treated with love and dignity and not feel neglected. We pray for those whose lives have been lost to COVID-19 and for their grieving families and friends as they struggle to accept what has happened. We pray that your arms enfold families, Lord, when they cannot hold on to each other, that you will bear the weight of their confusion and pain, and that they will feel your support through their grief, and that through this, you provide them with the strength and courage to face the challenges ahead. For ourselves, Lord, we thank you for your unconditional love and your presence with us at all times. We thank you that you accept us as we are, warts and all, on our good days and our bad days. We pray that we continue to place our trust in you and walk the path you lead us on. We pray that we do things in your strength and that we aren't tempted to try to do things in our own strength and become overwhelmed. We are so grateful, Lord, for your faithfulness to us, even when ours falters. We ask that you continue to draw us closer to you, and that your peace surrounds us, those we love, and those we ought to love, each and every day. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And so we close now, before the throne of God. Let us just be still. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the worship that we've shared. We thank you for those who have taken part. And we just pray, Father God, that we will feel and experience your presence with us. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.